Praise God, praise God. Let the people of God say amen, amen. I welcome you to the Bread Broadcast, a Bible teaching program from Eternal Food Evangelistic Organization, where we edify, we exalt, and we challenge believers to the Great Commission. Here, we also call sinners to repentance through the gospel of Jesus Christ. Thank you for joining us. Today, we have a lot to do. So we're just gonna dive in straight away. The topic is God's diagnosis of the heart and its cure. It's a heavy subject. I'm totally relying on the Holy Spirit because it's really condensed. So we can make our time. So the topic is God's diagnosis of the heart and its cure. And the case study is Adam and Eve. And a short reading is going to be Genesis, the book of beginnings. Genesis chapter 3, verse 1. We stop at 12. So we are reading 12 verses this time. Genesis chapter 3, verse 1. We stop at 12. Let us pray. Father, we thank you. Thank you, Father, for you got the whole world in your hands. Thank you, for you are the stability of our times, and our times are in your hands. Father, we pray that this time that you have given us the opportunity to hear what you have to say about the human heart, give us the grace to be humble, to receive your diagnosis, to agree with you so that we can find cure in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Our foundation text is the book of Jeremiah, chapter 17, verse 9. If you are a Bible student, you are already saying it right now. Foundation text, Jeremiah 17, 9. It says, the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? What is God's diagnosis of the human heart? The human heart is, number one, is a deception zone. The human heart is a tool of deception. What some call curious mind is actually not. Listen up, okay? We're gonna bump ourselves on this in this lesson. Sometimes Bible teaching goes that way, okay? Sometimes we just have to tell the truth in love. It's going to be difficult, but we have to say the truth. So what some people call curious is not. A deceived mind is a daring mind, all right? That wants to see what happens if they go ahead with their planned actions. Additionally, a deceived mind, now I'll be using mind, heart, and person interchangeably. So I'm still talking about a person. So a deceived individual wants to enjoy the present moment, disregard all cautions, and think of dealing with the consequences of their actions later on. Look at Eve, our case study. She did not forget the command given to them by God. No. She quoted God word for word to the serpent. She said, God has said we should not eat of the fruit of the tree that is in the midst of the garden. You see. But she chose to believe the lies of the serpent and chose not to think of the death part that God pronounced on disobedience of his command. What happened? She was curious. She was daring. She wanted to see what's gonna happen if I take the fruit and eat it, you see. When a self-professing Christian engages in any kind of lies, it may be marital lies, financial lies, or lying as lying to tell some stories that are not there, any type of lies, when you as a self-professing Christian engage in such, and you think, listen up, God, we understand, because I found myself in this position before I became a child of God. I was just going to church because my mama said I had to go to church, and I will be doing some bad stuff, and I will think, oh, God will understand. No, it doesn't. Or you think God will lower his standard of absolute holiness that he demands from the followers of Jesus Christ. If you believe that, you have been deceived. All right? If you think, well, as long as I pray, I fast, I give money to the church, I go to church every Sunday, I attend Bible fellowship and do good things to people, God will understand the rest, and you are engaging in unholiness as a practice, as a way of life, any kind of holiness, lying, fornication, whatever unholiness you have involved yourself in. It doesn't matter if you're a bishop or you are the Pope. If you think God will lower his standard, you have been deceived. Let's go to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 7. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 7. For God hath not called us unto uncleanness, but unto holiness. That's it. Jesus did not die on the cross to come and make this world a better place for you. No. He died, he went through that horrendous treatment because he needed to call holy people from the world unto himself. He came to make us holy. Let's go to 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 15. We stop at 16. 1 Peter 15 to 16. But as he, Jesus, who has called you is holy, so be holy in all manner of conduct. Because it is written, be ye holy, you must be holy, another version says, for I am holy. So if you call yourself a Christian and you are still engaged in some horrible stuff, you gossip, you lie on your tax returns, and you think God will lower his standard, you are kidding. Okay? God will not. So you can change today, because you have been deceived. But by the power of the Holy Spirit, you can start living a holy life, a separated, consecrated life. We can't do it on our own, no. But when the Holy Spirit is in the house, the Holy Spirit lives this holiness through our lives, and that's a confirmation for you that indeed you have been saved. When you begin to live a reformed life without repentance, deception of any kind can lead to destruction of all kinds. Let me back up. Because if you engage in financial lies and you are caught, it will destroy your reputation, your marriage. I mean, you cannot tell to what extent that destruction will go. Without repentance, deception of any kind can lead to destruction of all kinds. Moving on. God looked at the human heart and he says, it's not only a deception zone, it's also a desperate zone. A desperate heart knows a wrong has been committed. Oh yeah, they are not stupid. Oh no. But it fails to retreat, you see. A desperate heart thinks it's hopeless to go back. I already did it anyway. I committed what I'm not supposed to. I did what I'm not supposed to do. So what's the point? There's no point going back. They go on with a false hope that things may turn out right, eventually, in the path they have chosen. Even though it's a wrong path. Adam had the chance to stop the evil that started with Eve's deception. You see, Eve was deceived, but Adam was not. No. But rather, Adam continued the madness, you see. Adam presented a desperate and a wicked heart at this point. Because he knew, Eve, what did you do? You took the fruit you were not supposed to eat. Are you crazy? Uh-uh. What did he do? He took it and he ate it as well. That was a desperate and a wicked heart. By the time we get to Genesis chapter 3, verse 7, and we stop at 8, we are not going to read that. I'll paraphrase it. What did Adam and Eve do? They went ahead in their foolishness and collected fig leaves and sold it to cover themselves. These were people who were initially covered by the glory of God. You see, instead of looking up to say, God, we goofed. We messed things up. What are we going to do, Lord? Have mercy. No. Adam thought, we can fix this. You know, he's the man. So they sewed fig leaves together. And when God came and called out to them, guess where they were? They were hiding. They refused to show up. We should have run out to say, God, I'm in trouble. I did what I wasn't supposed to do. But what did they do? They ran away and they were hiding, you see. They kept going in the wrong path. For anyone, please listen up. If you're an unbeliever, you're too smart, you are on your high horse, and you think you're too wonderful, too good to be damned, listen up. For anyone who, after listening to the loving voice of God through the preaching of the saving gospel, see, all you can hear in this Bible is Jesus loves you as a sinner and he wants to save you. That's why he died for you. He wants to take you to heaven. That's the good news. After listening to such good news of Jesus, and you still choose to continue in your own way, at that point, God looks at you and says, your heart is wicked. And the book of Psalms says, God is angry with the wicked every day. Got it? Every day. Now, just like Adam presented a desperate and wicked heart by continuing the evil that his wife started. And if you continue as well, you are acting like Adam. And you will get the reward of eternal damnation unless you change. You see, God doesn't want you to be damned. That's why he sent me here to confront you. You see, and really, I'm not the one confronting you. It's the Holy Spirit confronting you through the Word of God, you see. Because God loves you so much, he doesn't want you to go to hell. No. Let's go to John chapter 3, verse 36. The gospel according to John chapter 3, verse 36. He who believes in the Son has everlasting life. That is, if you surrender to Jesus and say, you know what, Lord, you are right, I am wrong. If you can confess that you are less perfect than God, that you are not perfect like God is, and ask Jesus to come into your life, the Bible says you will have everlasting life. And he who does not believe the Son of God, Jesus Christ, shall not see life. You see, when people die, they don't die. The body dies, but the soul lives on. Either in the lake of fire or in heaven, you see. But the wrath of God abides on him. If you walk away from here and still continue in your own way, saying, I don't need God, the Bible says the wrath of God is upon you. But God doesn't want that for you. To be afar from God is to be at war with God. To be afar from God is to be at war with God. God is not at war with you. No. He sent his son to die for you. You are the one waging war against God. And you can't win. So you can change right here, right now. Just stay with me. All right? Now, God looked at the heart of man. Is not only a deception zone, it's not only a desperate zone, God says is a dark zone. The human heart runs its channel into a bottomless pit. Stay with me. No one knows the depth to which their heart can draw them. Nobody knows. Not even the lady speaking to you. No. The human mind is the workshop of fantasies. And without the Spirit of God, that's the difference, folks. The only difference between the lives of those who have believed Jesus and those who have not is that we have the Holy Spirit. He will tell us what we cannot watch. He will tell us the way we cannot think. If we are not thinking right, we say, Josephine Zion, you can't think like that, you see. Without the Spirit of God to check or correct our heart, it is easy for an individual to become a reprobate. It's easy. Haven't you seen them all around? Huh? Almost half naked, talking nonsense, and they say they are this, they are that, they have money, they are celebrities. And you look at them and you shake your head. Like, so sad. You see, they look at themselves, they think, oh, I'm wonderful. But decent, intelligent, spiritually minded people look at them and we just look at them like, wow, this is really sad. You see, because their minds have become reprobate. What started as disobedience in the lives of Adam and Eve snowballed, watch this, into murder in their son, Cain, you see, is spiraling down, you see, channeling down to the bottomless pit. And Cain, their son, killed his brother, Abel. So it is with anyone who persistently disregard the call to salvation. Listen up, track with me, watch this. A time will come, if you persistently ignore the gospel, that your heart will become very cold and hardened because you have succeeded in deadening your conscience. That's a lie nobody should get you. It's a terrible, terrible Rubicon that nobody should cross. At that point, God said, my spirit will not always strive with men. At that point, the Holy Spirit will stop working through your conscience to convict you, to convince you that you need Jesus. At that point, God says, you really want to go there? Help yourself. One pastor said, hell is God's answer to a sinner's prayer. You see, God will not send people to hell. Oh no. People will send themselves to hell by their choices. At that point, the individual has been gripped by the evil dark zone of the heart. And there is no telling the kind of evil they can commit. I mean, you will hear of some politicians that they look like muckety muck in the society, and when they begin to dig about their private lives, you are going, are you serious? Really? You won't even believe that they could descend so low. Why can't they? When there's no Holy Spirit, human beings can do anything. The young man that killed himself, the Austin, Syria bomber, that killed himself this week, people were shocked. His friends, his relatives, they were like, what happened? You see, when the Holy Spirit is not in the house, there's no telling how dark the heart of human can become. Let's go to 2 Kings chapter 8, verse 12. We stop at 13. It's a little bit heavy read, but this will give you a good example of how dark a human heart can become. 2 Kings chapter 8, verse 12 to 13. This was Azahel, who was sent by his boss, the king of Syria, to prophet Elisha. And after they finished talking the king's business, then Elisha looked at Azahel and began to cry. And Azahel asked, "What's the matter, my lord?" He was asking Elisha. Azahel asked him. Elisha replied, "I know the terrible things you will do to the people of Israel. You will burn their fortified cities, kill their young men with the sword, dash their little children to the ground, and rip open their pregnant women." And Azahel said, "But what? Is your servant a dog that he should do this great thing? Like, really? Am I an animal that will be doing all that kind of horrible things?" And Elisha said, "The Lord has shown me that you shall be king over Syria." You see, the prophet of God, God opened his eyes. He could see a few years down the road. And guess what? Like the next chapter after that, 2 Kings chapter 8, the next chapter, Azahel became the king of Syria, just as the prophet said, really? And he became so power drunk, he did exactly the things that the prophet said. The same Azahel, few years back, that said, "Am I a dog that would do all those horrible things?" He did it. See, the omniscient God opened the eyes of his servant and told Azahel, "This is how dark your heart will become," even when Azahel didn't even know it, you see. Like a rudderless ship, so is a godless heart a costless life. Josephine Zion, somebody needs to hear that again, so say it slowly, please. Like a rudderless ship, so is a godless heart a costless life. Now, all we have been talking about was the bad news part of the lesson. You know how the Lord teaches us on this program. It's got to be balanced, exhort, and challenge. So we have challenged ourselves. Now let's encourage ourselves. Here's the good news. How can a deceived, desperate, and dark heart be cured? There's only one way: the divine zone. The heart has to go into the divine zone. The only medication that can cure a deceived, desperate, and dark heart of Adam in an individual is only found in Jesus. Finito. That's it. It's only found in Jesus. Sephene, the French people will say. God is ready to plant a new heart from heaven in anyone who dares to declare their spiritual bankruptcy and surrenders to the supreme judgment of God, to which there is no appeal, that they are a sinner. That's God's judgment. He looked at the world and he said, "You are all sinners," because Adam had passed his corrupt DNA into all of you. If you can agree with that and say, Lord, I'm spiritually bankrupt. I have no goodness in me that can bring me to heaven. Then you are ready, you see. To ask for forgiveness of sin from God and ask Jesus to come into our heart and make us one of his children is to enter the divine zone. With the new heart that God will give you from heaven comes the Holy Spirit, who helps believers in our faith walk by encouraging us, by directing us, convicting us, cleansing us, and sometimes chastising us as the need arises. This is how an individual can have a spiritually healthy heart whose beautiful result spills into every area of one's natural life. When somebody becomes changed by the power of the Holy Spirit, people know, oh, she doesn't cuss out people like before. He stopped drinking. You see, people will know because you have been changed from the inside. John 14 verse 26. John chapter 14 verse 26. But the Comforter, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, in Jesus' name, he shall teach you all things and bring all things to your remembrance, whatsoever I have said unto you. You see, if you are a believer and your heart has been deceived and you come to God for forgiveness and you start dwelling in the Word of God, the Holy Spirit will remind you when you are about to make mistakes. Say, what did you read this morning? And you go, oh yeah, okay, I'm sorry, Father. And you quickly move away from that sin. And if you're a pagan and you cry out to Jesus, he will give you the Holy Spirit. He will cleanse you of the slime of sins. And then you can become my brother or my sister by the way of blood of Jesus Christ. To make peace with God is to have peace with God. To make peace with God, say that with me, is to have peace with God. Amen. So what is God's diagnosis of the human heart? God looked at the human heart and he said, it's a deception zone. That is, it ignores the warning signs of future consequences of our actions. God says it's a desperate zone. It advances in disobedience instead of retreating from it. God says the human heart is a dark zone. It pushes the limit button to see how far we can go. How can it be cured? It can be cured by entering the divine zone. This is admitting God's verdict of our need of his forgiveness and salvation. Now, the evil cycle of heart disease can be stopped at this moment, right here, right now. It is not hopeless as you could have thought. No, it's not. As long as you are still listening to me and you can compute what I'm saying, your situation is not hopeless. Don't say, oh, I've done so many bad things. Don't worry. Jesus will take you just as you are. If you will recognize your sin and ask for his forgiveness, okay? We all need forgiveness. Oh, come on. We all need forgiveness. However, while a believer, I'm a believer, I have the Holy Spirit in me, while my need for forgiveness is about continuing my father-child relationship with God, you see, whenever I sin, the relationship stops. Because God cannot behold sin. And the Holy Spirit will make me uncomfortable. So I have to confess and then I'll be back in fellowship with my daddy. Never, you see. That is my kind of forgiveness as a believer that I need. But if you're an unbeliever, your kind of forgiveness that you need is to help you escape the imminent judgment of God that will take unbelievers to the lake of fire if they refuse to receive Jesus, you see. So we all need forgiveness, but it pulls apart, okay? So if you are an unbeliever, the forgiveness you are asking right now is, Lord, I don't want to go to hellfire, you see. And he will save you. Then you can now become a child of God, and you can now have the same kind of relationship that people like me and believers who have fellowship with Jesus Christ, the kind of relationship, father-child relationship, then you too can have it. Jesus doesn't want you to choose hellfire. That's why he died on the cross for you. However, the choice is yours. Let us pray. Father, help us. May we not be deceived by our own heart. For as many who want to turn the course of their lives around, Father, I pray that as they go to the link that will come up after I finish praying, to go there to know what they need to do to be saved, you will grant them the understanding. Open their eyes in Jesus' name. Thank you, Father God. In Jesus' name, I will pray. Amen. I will see you next week, only if Jesus has not split the sky open.